Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage Lieutenant General Bob Wood, U.S. Army retired Executive Vice President, AFCEA International.
Well, come on. Are you awake? Let's go. All right. We got a whole good afternoon here and a great panel in front of you. It's going to be a good one. We are very glad you're with us this afternoon. We're going to look at some of the industry perspectives. Very important. You've heard it spoken many times already in the conference about the partnerships, importance of industry, and the capabilities that reside therein. We've got a very, very distinguished and experienced panel. I think you'll enjoy it today, led by a wonderful moderator. Really to cap the morning, which had General Crawford's really signal alarm for where he need to be, what the institution needs to be doing, the fact the progress they've made, and how they're proceeding forward in modernizing the network and moving towards the enterprise and its modernization. Then with General Gallagher and General Bassett, what a great collection of insight. It's very clear that the Army is interested in not just getting the job understood, but getting the job done. The two of them side by side working both sides of both the acquisition and procurement side, and then the requirements and those established. So it really is time now to talk a bit about how we're going to get those solutions, how we're going to build the solutions, the SEMA solutions that we need to help our Army proceed forward in a rather complicated, congested, contested environment. To do that, we have just a tremendous moderator and a wonderful panel. General Hernandez is our moderator, and I could just probably stop there, but I'm going to add one or two more things, because you know him, you've seen him in the space, you've seen him here at Fort Gordon, knowing his background, his experience as the first commander of Army Cyber, understanding the fact that he is now the leader of the Army Cyber Institute up at West Point. If you haven't met or experienced that group, remarkable set of talented professionals, educators, researchers, practitioners, really bringing together the academic force to advance the cyber capabilities. And I last saw Rhett, and he may talk about it down at Jack Voltaic, an event that was remarkable in its ambition, and it was looking at a cyber attack on the city of Houston, along with a hurricane, along with a force deploying through the port. Now, go. But Army Cyber Institute there, led by General Hernandez with a lot of other great professionals, were really looking at critical infrastructure protection. He may say more about it. But I would tell you, I want to hear what he has to say now about the building the capabilities to help the SEMA force. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome the panel and General Hernandez.
Well, Bob, are you sure you're talking about me? First, let me just say it's really bright in here. And say first thanks. Special thanks to AFCEA. Thanks to Cyber COE and to the community of Augusta for making this conference possible, but more importantly, for how it has grown over the years. It's just phenomenal to come back and see the continued growth and the unbelievable exchange of dialogue. I want to thank industry, government, and academia for all that you continue to do for national security, because in my view, this is about national security. It's great to see you here and to participate in this powerful agenda. So today, as Bob mentioned, we have a great industry panel lined up for you. As you know and you've heard this week, the Army has done and continues to do a lot of work to operationalize SEMA, but really can't do it without the solutions that industry can bring to this. They've in fact reworked and published a new doctrine, increased the cyber and electronic warfare force structure. They're creating SEMA cells at all levels, and really bringing new equipment to bear in an area that really needs it if we're going to operate in this contested and congested environment. Absolutely, SEMA capabilities are critical to the multi-domain battle that is already here, as you've heard. Integrating cyber, EW, and information ops is essential. Today's threats are doing it well. They're significant and they continue to grow. Operations in Ukraine provide some insights into today, but also as well as considerations for tomorrow. Threats have demonstrated the ability to not only impact tactical operations, but to have strategic effects. And we must increase our resiliency to mitigate threat impacts, increase our ability to fight through disruptions, and in the end, assure our mission, whatever that might be. The battlefield we're preparing for has changed, and the spectrum will be more congested and continuously contested. In the end, we have to be able to synchronize defense and offense, cyber, EW, and IO capabilities, in my view, with other information-related capabilities, as well as the other warfighting functions to achieve desired effects. Today, our panel is going to explore the SEMA environment from their industry and experience perspective and discuss areas where industry can help be part of the solution. So here are some questions for you to consider as you listen to our panelists. During this era of strategic competition, how do we stack up? What challenges and gaps do we have to address to create solutions? How do we increase our capability today, but also while preparing for the future from the tactical edge to the strategic end? What should our priorities be? We heard it today, we heard some of it yesterday, we're going to continue to hear it, but how do we create and maintain a rapid ability to acquire capabilities, but also to ensure that we are ahead of this ever-changing threat? And then how do we increase the strength of our defenses while growing offensive capability in each of these spaces? In the end, how do we increase our resiliency? And from a other perspective, how do we not only increase automation, but leverage AI and machine learning? Bob told me I had to say that because you have to say that on every summer Augusta day to keep up with what I believe and what we're seeing are increasingly AI-driven threats. There aren't enough humans to put to this problem, so we're going to have to figure out how to do it with our best minds to leverage our machines. What planning and training capabilities will increase our ability to integrate SEMA? And then how can we best leverage partnerships, public-private partnerships? And in the end, anything with power sends a signal in the spectrum, and how do we not only manage it, but dominate it? Now, today's panelists are going to answer all these questions and more.
That's right.
Actually, any questions you want to ask is what they're ready to do. And the more you ask, the less I will have to ask. They'll highlight what they're doing and provide some insights on how industry can be part of the critical SEMA work that's being done, not only in the Army, but across DoD. So I'm excited to introduce our panelists. First, next to me, Colonel Retired Laurie Moe Buckhout, President and CEO of the Corvus Group, with experience in a wide range of operational assignments, including Chief of the Army's EW Division, where she became a good friend and mentor. At times, she probably called me a tormentor. But for the last decade, has been influential in helping the Army understand global ground force EW challenges and requirements. Next to Laurie is Gus Mendiola, CTO and systems engineer, manager of Army Enterprise Region for Cisco Systems, a retired Army officer, fellow West Point grad, bringing technology support and solutions to the Army with education and deep experience in cyber. It's great to have both of you here. Next to Gus, Major General Retired Jennifer Knapper, Vice President and Segment Manager of Army and Cyber Accounts for Perspecta. That is a mouthful, Jennifer. Jennifer brings more than 30 years of experience in cyber, telecommunications, and IT with experience at all levels. As my deputy for Army Cyber Command, she was a fantastic leader, teammate, coach, and friend. Welcome, Jennifer. On the end, batting cleanup, who told me that if all the time's not used, he will, to ensure there are no questions. So we won't let that happen. Ronald Fogg Hahn, Executive Vice President, Critical Infrastructure Protection Strategies for AECOM, a great partner for us. Fogg's a 20-year Marine Corps veteran who understands the threat and technology and is a recognized expert in cyber terrorism, electromagnetic spectrum, and EW. He, too, is a trusted professional and friend. Fogg, it's great to have you here with us today. So with that, let's get started. The format's pretty simple. I've asked everyone to provide some comments. 5 to 7 minutes, and then I'll ask a couple of questions based on what they tell us, but most importantly, I'd ask for you to send in your questions so that everyone leaves with an appreciation of what industry can do and what you can do to be a part of this significant fight we're embarked on. With that, let's get started. Mo, over to you, please.
All right, sir. Thank you. So I was asking friends and associates yesterday on what they find the biggest challenge in the electronic warfare space right now. And I think General Fogarty's words yesterday were brilliant, talking about how the Army had started off with cyber, and then they bring in electronic warfare, and now they had to start to bring information operations, information warfare in, you know, to sort of make a whole. I think that's absolutely brilliant, because one of the things that we really ought to do is look at what our near peers are doing. And if you look at Russia, you look at China, you know, you look at North Korea, Russia and China in particular, though, they're using different centers of gravity to achieve dominance in the information space. If you look at China, they're going and building a Silk Road through Africa for trade. They're bringing in weapon systems. In fact, if you watch the news, Eric Prince with Blackwater actually was in the news last year because they were trying to bring in contract aircraft to assist with some of the African nations and making sure that they had you know, humanitarian relief, food supplies, et cetera. Well, on the down low, he was actually weaponizing these aircraft. So they're bringing in almost mercenary, or they're attempting to, through Chinese contractors, almost mercenary capabilities to make sure that their Silk Road through Africa remains open and remains to them. So they're sort of doing it without firing a shot across the big, you know, spectrum, keeping the warlords under control. And of course, Russia's doing it by interference strategically, tactically, all over the place. What they've done in the Ukraine, what they did to our elections, they are all over the spectrum of military conflict and beyond. So I think that we're dealing with a lot of interesting areas right now that are all sort of coming together. But my challenge discussed yesterday was in electronic warfare, building EW capabilities, electronic warfare acquisition. And some of the comments were made yesterday. Mark Dotson made a very good point. He spoke well about trying to make programs into all things for all people. And so when you start a JSIDS program going and you start defining a requirement, then somebody else jumps in on it. And you got an EW piece of kit that needs to be a cyber piece of kit also. And then you have something where it's like, you know, we need to be able to go to social media through this thing and make it do all sorts of things across the information sphere. Other people aren't doing that. Our near peers are not necessarily doing that. A lot of them are using kit especially made for one of those three capabilities, and they're focusing on that, and it's being integrated at a different level. So I think Mark Dotson's points, Colonel Dotson's points were very well made. We need to be careful of making all things for all people. Sometimes you need to focus on one good capability and get it right, and then integrate it at a different level. Again, looking at what our near peers are doing, you look at their EW kit, for instance, you look at Russia, it's echeloned. You've got stuff for the close fight, the mid fight, and the deep fight. You have stuff that can fight from sanctuary 200 kilometers back and can influence hundreds of kilometers itself in terms of spectrum, in terms of power, and it can go on the move, not even at the quick halt or at the, you know, the long halt. You have a capability that is on something Hemet-sized, you know, tractor-trailer-sized, that can actually, you know, move, shoot, and communicate, if you will, all by itself, not at a quick halt. Something to think about. We have been working on EW kit that is mostly at the very tactical level, going right into phase three. We need to be looking at phase zero, phase one, phase two, like the Russians are, like the Chinese are. Influence operations before you ever even get there. And, of course, one of the big challenges with the Russians is going to be getting inside their, you know, protected space. So another challenge. I think being able to focus on areas discreetly, one at a time, and being able to do more than one thing well at a time. So we've been doing cyber very well. Doesn't mean we can't do EW very well simultaneously. You know, we're a big, smart army. There's a lot of things we can do at the same time, and we don't necessarily have to stop, focus on one thing, take a breather, move on to the next. You know, there's a whole lot of smart people running this stuff, and simultaneity of operations and thought is critical. But I think probably the most important thing I heard yesterday from my industry friends is transparency and collaboration between defense acquisition personnel and industry. You know, right now, we're trying to keep up with technology at the pace of JSIDs, and the two really could not be more different. You know, you look at Moore's Law and how quickly things change and how quickly we have to be able to leap ahead. I mean, it's software alone. So if you've got, you know, software capabilities, which a lot of our, you know, engineered capabilities are now software defined, et cetera, if you've got that at the pace of just running through JSIDs and let's get an ICD and a CDD, get it in the JROC and everything, just scheduling to be on the JROC, and by then the software has already changed completely. Just the time it gets to schedule something to get on the JROC. So, you know, there needs to be, I think, listening to some of my industry friends with great ideas, they kind of want to get on the ground floor. And so they're looking for ways to have transparency and collaboration early on in their requirements development process. Because there's a whole lot of, you know, things that you never even thought about. You know, caveman can't even visualize a car. When I started out in EW, I was very much a caveman. And there was a whole lot of folks who worked with me at that point to get me to understand the art of the possible. A lot of industry folks. At Department of the Army, that was not necessarily my mission, was to be taking briefs from industry on, you know, the capabilities of EW and stuff. But you needed to do that, and I think that in the Army acquisition process, it's critical that industry is able to engage. One of my friends yesterday said, you know what, if you have a portal on FESBIDS Ops, and you have, you know, a SMO code, which is your security clearance you have for your company, you're able to articulate that into a site where you can be validated and actually work collaboratively in a trusted space, there's a lot of power to that. So, sir, I think I've exceeded my time.
You've done great. Thank you. One of my roles now as a senior mentor on Medicare is to be able to say, I remember when. And I would say that it wasn't too many years ago that we had no transparency. I was not allowed to say offense with the word cyber. We were not allowed to say attack with the words electronic warfare. That discussion's routine now. So transparency is increasing. The question then becomes, as we think about this challenge, is how do we increase the coordination and the collaboration and the communication in that more transparent world to get at the challenges that we have to better assist DoD and others. Great comments, thank you. Gus, please.
All right, thanks sir, appreciate it. Good afternoon. First, I wanna thank AFCEA for the opportunity to participate in this industry panel. The conference so far has been fantastic for us and I really appreciate being a part of it. I'm extremely privileged to be able to represent Cisco and my team at Cisco and be here with these great professionals, some of whom I served with not that long ago. I wanna share something real quick with you. You know, it was extremely motivating to see a group of young, brand new, bright-eyed second lieutenants running around the shore floor yesterday and this morning. It just reminded me of us 20 years ago with what I'll call this glimmer of hope, right? This glimmer of hope and this insatiable drive. It was extremely refreshing and I appreciate them taking the time to come out and see all of us, their industry industry partners. So for the three of you that follow me on Twitter, you probably figured out what my topic is gonna be, but for the rest of you that don't follow me just yet, at Gus Mendiola, by the way, I'll spend the next few minutes talking about embracing the concepts of security automation to enable not just the cybersecurity fight, but how we deliver the network and its services to our collective customer. I wanna impart three key concepts with you. The first one is the value proposition to act is extremely simple. Number two, automate the simple stuff and we can focus on the difficult. That's really a key element there. And number three, we as industry are embracing education. We need to pass that along to our government friends, right? To our customers and embracing that education and training because it is a call to action for how we use these new tool sets to be able to fight our adversary. Last year, Gartner published a study that introduced another acronym. We needed yet another acronym, but here we go. The acronym is SOAR. I've seen a couple versions of this in the research I've done, but it's pretty simple. It's security orchestration, automation, and response. And the findings from Gartner were pretty straightforward, as you might imagine. Security teams are struggling to keep up with the deluge of alerts from an increasing set of tools that industry continues to provide to them. Most security teams still rely on manual processes, document-based procedures for operations, which lead to issues like longer lead time to onboard new analysts, stale procedures, tribal knowledge, and inconsistencies in execution, things that we have all seen in our day-to-day practices. The increasing hostile threat combined with the lack of people, expertise, and budget are driving organizations towards these SOAR technologies. It's a must, it's an imperative to be able to do what the terms we've heard over and over is to do more with less, right? You've all heard that. Again, not a real surprise with those findings, but I did find it very positive that as part of that report that there is a recognition in the tool sets that we as industry are providing are maturing, and that they're somewhat being adopted. And I say somewhat, that's actually pretty good news. But what my concern is that as a user community, our customers within the government, are we ready for this paradigm shift for how we think, train, and fight in order to leverage these new capabilities that industry is introducing into this space? So first, let's talk about the value proposition. The value proposition, again, very straightforward. Adapt, or we're going to lose the fight. And that is not an option. Our adversary has embraced automation, just as you discussed. Our adversary has embraced automation in all aspects of how they attack. And if we want to be able to keep up with it, we need to do the same thing. So from my perspective, the value proposition is very, very, very straightforward. We must build and enable our networks to defend themselves. This technology already exists, and the foundational components are already deployed throughout the enterprise. We really just need to turn on those capabilities, get ourselves educated and educate our customer and get those capabilities turned on. The whole goal is to really get at that whiteboard that General Fogarty was talking about, right? Shorten the gap between sense and act, and we do that through automation. So what are some of the lessons learned that us from industry can share with our fellow partners in industry as well as the government? When our CEO Chuck Robbins talks to our customers at Cisco and our industry partners, our stated objectives are that automation must first save on the operational costs, the cost that it takes in order to run the network, but for the purpose of redirecting those cost savings into making the network more secure. So you save on one end in order to make investments in the other. Again, not a huge surprise. So how do we get started? What do we automate? Again, this is not meant to be an exhaustive list, but to give you some food for thought, some things to think about. Some are simple, and some are a little more complicated. So again, let's have a starting point. We need to fix the easy stuff, fix the routine stuff. General Crawford talked about this morning, right? He talked about getting at that network hygiene and eliminate some of that operator error. Those very basic and fundamental things that we do day to day sometimes really, really come back to bite us. So if we leverage automation, what it happens to do is it forces organizations, like our customer, to really look at what their procedures are, to really operationalize what their procedures are, apply them uniformly across the enterprise, create these operational templates that can then be automated and applied uniformly across the enterprise. The byproduct of actually doing this is that we actually improve the user experience. What a concept there, to actually be able to improve how our networks actually provide services to our customer. More directly, to address security issues and automating is automating network access control. A lot of discussion around how we do that. And I think we're finally making some inroads with things like Comply to Connect. There's a couple of different pilots going on that we're working on in order to, again, automate how our users connect to the network. It's not just about determining whether they can or cannot connect, but when they cannot connect, establishing why and automating the remediation and then get the users connected so they can get to work, be productive, and actually make a use of this network. Thirdly, and again, talking about AI and machine learning, we must leverage machine learning and AI in order to automate a network response. This technology has really come a long way in a very short amount of time. The technology takes feedback from all parts of the network, to including the endpoints, to make educated automatic responses to perceived anomalies. These anomalies could be threats or it could be something benign, but again, that's something that the AI has to learn as part of it being turned on and receiving this information from the network. The best thing about it is that, again, the foundational components of it are already deployed on the network. We just need to educate our customer and we just need to have them turn it on. So enough on automation. I'm confident that you have an idea of all the things that are in the realm of the possible. And in the, I probably went a little over time, but in the short time that I'm gonna get allotted to finish up, let me talk about what is fueling this change in automation. And that is the universal recognition that the best way to interact with all these data sets is through APIs. You've all have heard of this, right? The application programming interface. Everything that we produce comes with an API. Everything. If you have one of these, you interact with APIs on a daily basis, minute by minute. So how do we get started, and how do we get our customers started wrapping themselves around this particular technology? So very briefly, by a quick show of hands, how many of you use home automation? Everybody does. Okay, great. Okay, fantastic. I do too, right? So we're talking about lights, maybe door locks or things like that. I'm gonna give you guys a little bit of homework, share something with you. You didn't think I was going to give you some homework, right? So I'll give you a little bit of homework. There's an app called IFTTT. It stands for If This Then That. And if you're familiar with programming, that is the most basic conditional construct, most basic conditional framework in programming. And what it actually allows you to do, it's a really neat ecosystem. I guarantee that things that are available on that app, you already have at home. And it allows you to explore automation at an API level and automate some of the things you have at home. So for example, we were talking about this a little earlier. I turned over my air conditioner controls over to my power company. They said they're gonna give me a break by whenever they adjust my temperature by 1 degree. I live in Texas. Power's a little expensive out there and it's pretty hot. So whenever they change, whenever it changes, I get a notification from someone that says, hey, something's going on, you may need to pay attention. There's an alert. The other thing I use it for is whenever my wife goes in there and she changes the temperature in the house, right? I need to know because I need to make sure I have my blanket. She really likes it cold in there. But again, embracing automation, right? This is something that you can explore. We first need to embrace it and then demonstrate this to our customers and have our customers embrace this as well. The adoption of this type of technology requires really a radical shift in how we train and how we fight. We need to look at how we are teaching our own workforce and how our customer is teaching those troopers that are coming in order to operate and maintain the network, what we're teaching them. And that is all about coding and programming. The amount of training available out there is tremendous. You can go to the Microsoft Virtual Academy and download free training. You can go to Google Python and download free training. You can even go to Cisco's Developers Network and, again, download free training. It's all there for us to explore, for a customer to explore, again, at no additional charge. And more importantly, it can provide a potential guide for how we incorporate this into the curriculum of this great establishment, right? Fort Gordon training our customers, training those lieutenants that were running around the show floor. It's really a call to action. How do we start to prepare them? How do we start to prepare ourselves? How do we embrace this technology going forward? So I'm going to circle back to where I started. The value proposition is extremely simple. We need to change. We need to adapt. We need to be able to react at the speed of cyber. Otherwise, we're going to lose. Number two, automate the routine. Focus on the simple tasks so you have time to work on the hard ones. There's plenty of hard ones out there, trust me. And number three, embrace the technology. Prepare our force for the future by embracing that technology. Again, thank you. I'd like to spend more time with you guys down at the booth, and I really appreciate your time. Thank you, sir.
Great, Gus, thanks. I use IFTTT to tell me every time my wife uses the credit card. So there's a lot of other uses besides power. And I would be remiss if I didn't say this, because I think every operational requirement is not just driven about efficiencies with respect to what you can save, and certainly a requirement to ensure that we're more secure, but we ought not lose track that everyone that we do is all about increasing operational effectiveness and how we do that in a risk environment. And we'd welcome those questions as you think about that. And then the last one, I think, would be to really get some insights from Gus and others here on what can the Army really do to leverage AI, because we know where industry is. Now, what can the Army do to get at it? I'd love to hear that question come back at us. Jennifer, please.
So thank you to AFCEA and to General Hernandez for asking us to come participate on the panel with them here today. I'm probably going to take a little bit different tack than, see, there's that Marine Navy term. Take a different tack than the rest of the team here. But my brain went kind of dead when he said 20 years ago we were the second lieutenants. Try 35, my friend. So after that, I didn't hear anything else you said. So cyber electromagnetic, this operational domain that we've been talking about for a while now, 12 years. 12 years ago is when we started talking about it at PACOM, 10 years ago at JTFGNO, and now we're finally getting to discuss it, as the boss said, out in the public a little bit more openly. But this operational domain that you can actually have effects in and through. A lot of attention is paid to the wired, to the IP, the internet protocols, and that part of it, and probably not enough to the wireless or the mobile. And so I'm going to put this in a little bit different perspective and a different spin. So I started off in the Army as a CISO, not a CIGO or S6, a CISO. And that stood for Communications Electronics. And I was in a field artillery battalion. And as the field artillery officers in the table would tell you, that meant if it plugged in or had a battery, it was my responsibility, right? Didn't just count on radios.
And if it didn't work, it was more
your responsibility. It was more my, yeah, right. Including the mine detector was mine, okay? So because it had batteries. So I've never forgotten that. But the expectation was pretty simple, right? Redundant communications, secure. Redundant meant I had to have two forms, not two pieces of wire. Redundant communications, secure to every single battery and to every missile launcher, because we were nuclear capable. A whole different story, a different scary thought. We don't want to talk about tactical nukes, bad idea. So, but two, right? Redundant and secure. And I'm hearing it again today, redundant and secure. I've heard it for 35 years. And we had to understand the capabilities and limitations of both our AM and FM, of HF, of TROPO, if we ever saw it. If, you know, the few satellite vans that General Gallagher was talking about, we didn't see down in the field artillery battalions. But you had to understand LUF and MUF, which if you're not an HF person, you'll never remember. Some of us did and had to learn that. And the scary part to me, listening to some of the conversations today, is the CISO was also the one that had to understand the electronic capabilities of the Soviet Union and how to properly distinguish between meekening, intrusion, or jamming, and actually understand that. And yes, we did have, not spreadsheets, paper charts of which frequencies the bad intel guys or whoever was going to be on, so we wouldn't use them. And it was a horrible way to do business. But the same thread is pulling forward. We're here 35 years later talking about how do we integrate, how do we use the spectrum in the most efficient manner. The same conversations, technologies have changed dramatically. We have so much more capability now, and there's so much more we could be doing. And we were talking a little earlier about the whole battlefield is a battlefield of things emitting now, right? So maybe that's, everyone keeps saying reduce the footprint. Maybe that's a good thing. Maybe you can hide in the noise. But this morning, a wise gentleman said, he's quoting one of my favorite mentors, General Neighbors, and said, industry can give you a peek into the art of the possible. And so that's what I want to spend just a few minutes on today. Given all that's gone on in the 35 years and all the technologies that's changed and all the TTPs and the 20 year of experience, right, coming forward. Take a short trip on the art of the possible. Today, what if you could simultaneously, with something this size, not a truck, sense what emitters are near you, whether they're in your chart of things folks you should be seeing, and my smart device would pick whatever part of the spectrum it wants to use to send its message simultaneously, and I don't have to think about this. What if instead of giving me a salami slice, this then, according to Ed Francis, of spectrum for which I can't get enough bandwidth to actually send any data, and one way over here, and they, my poor little waveform won't do both, what if instead my emitter can pick and choose and change all the time into anything that's available at that moment? That's the art of the possible today. That's what your research labs have built out for you that is now being able to be taken to scale and look at in an enterprise manner. What if the management of that spectrum was just as flexible today? That's the art of the possible. Taking a step a little bit away from, I was the last Army person sent to Keesler for spectrum school. That's, you know, how long ago I enjoyed this. And then I worked for Colonel Francis for as his assistant three. But there is just so much going on out there today that there's no way the government guys can even begin to understand it. Those solutions are coming about not because the military asked for them because they thought of them, but because industry realizes they can't get more emitters out there unless they think differently about the spectrum and they manage it differently. Every other country does it different than us too, so that's a whole other challenge we can talk about another time. Two other quick arts of the possibles. We've been talking about software-defined networks for ever, right? It's nice to go out and look at what you can do once you have software-defined networks to scale. And there's some capabilities out there that have been built for what we call virtual assured networks. You can name it anything you want. The bottom line is what you can do to manipulate that network and change the emitters, what you can do to change the way the person or devices on the network think the network looks like. Think of agility and deception. Those are realities today and they're the possible. So I look forward to your questions. I always like coming to this event because I'm always learning, as Laurie said yesterday, when you get down on the floor and you see some of the things that are going on, it's mind-boggling. So thank you very much, appreciate it.
Great, thank you, Jennifer. Just a couple quick comments. I actually remember all that, because I have like seven more years added on to whatever you did. I think the redundant and secure, what's different that I would ask you to think about is it's a different set of redundancies and security. And I have a lot of people tell me over the last decade or so, we got to go back to where we were, and I'm telling them it's not all it was cracked up to be. And we're not going to go back to where that was. We can't afford to, so how do we gain redundancy and security in this 21st century world, which is different than what we've had to deal with in the past. And I think industry provides great value in some of the insights that Jennifer gave you to that. For all the panel members, I'm gonna come back to you here, assuming we don't have this question, and that is, how do we integrate all this? Now that you brought it up, we can't wait to hear the answer. Fogg, please.
Great, thanks, General Hernandez. First of all, thanks, AFCEA, just an absolutely fabulous event. It's been a real pleasure. We've really had an opportunity to work really closely with Army Cyber Institute and General Hernandez with Jack Voltaic too. And so it's really great to see this forum and see what's happening across both Army Cyber and the Army Cyber Institute. So first of all, I'm going to actually try and answer some of your questions. I'm going to deviate and talk about some of the questions. So first of all, the biggest challenge is we think about it. Everybody asks, how do we keep pace with technology? It's moving so rapidly, right? The first thing I think we need to do, and there's a lot of people that I've gotten to see that were kind of with me and many of the panel members here in the trenches when we were trying to create spectrum as a maneuver space. The first thing is you have to understand, what is the maneuver space? The maneuver space is much broader, I think, than when we think. We've tended to look at the logical and the physical worlds in different maneuver spaces. I don't think we can afford that. They are, in fact, in the same maneuver space. I see it in industry all the time. then they differentiate them, and that presents real challenges. So first thing we have to do is understand the maneuver space that we're operating in. You want to look at it, look at how, and Laurie put it out really well, how both the Russians and the Chinese operate. They leverage the entire maneuver space. So I look at cyber, I look at EW, I look at influence operations as tools within that maneuver space. So make sure we understand what that maneuver space is. By the way, we have a huge dependency on the civilian infrastructure for that maneuver space. And I think it's something something certainly we put to the test with Jack Voltaic too, and I think it was quickly, we quickly saw some of the disconnects of we don't understand how things are interconnected and interdependencies, right? Think about a major installation and trying to gear up for a major deployment and have no power or water, have no telecommunications. If you look at how the Russians employ, they don't just employ what we would consider traditional maneuver space. Our critical infrastructure is, in fact, a tremendously vulnerable and critical maneuver space, and they're operating in it today, and we need to understand that. I think when we look at how do we get industry, how do we leverage the best of industry, we have challenges. I see it every day. You know, when I was at the Joint Electronic Warfare Center working this, I look back now and realize how incredibly naive I was in just understanding industry challenges. I see this all the time, and it always makes me laugh. I haven't read an RFP probably in the last 10 years that doesn't have the word an emphasis on innovation. And I haven't read an RFP in the last 10 years that doesn't emphasize past performance. And show and document where you've used this solution in the past. You understand the dichotomy with innovation and past performance. So you're sitting there trying to say, how do I reply to, I've got a great new opportunity or way to do something better, but if I can't demonstrate how I've done it five times in the last 3 years, it doesn't count. So we have to allow room for innovation. We have to think much more holistically than we do today. We have to understand that our physical and our logical worlds have converged. It goes right back to if this, then that, right? So I can use something on the logical side to make something physical happen on the other end. I need to know where those interdependencies lie. Let's think about that app and how many things have to happen, right, from the time you type it in on your application on your mobile device to when something physically probably occurs at your residence. It's no different in modern warfare today. But we've isolated them. That's one of the reasons why I like SEMA. It's one of the reasons why I was very excited to be on this panel, because we have to understand the critical interdependencies. We can't view it from our own stovepipe. 9/11 happened, and I was immediately deployed down to CENTCOM to be the command EWO. And within 2 days on the job, I was being told, hey, start looking at how we're going to isolate target area. I was exceptionally well trained by the Marine Corps. I knew everything about Soviet IAD systems. I knew all the SAM systems. I know integrated air defense inside out and backwards. I had memorized frequencies, PRFs, pulse types, and everything else. Problem was, there wasn't any of that in the battle space. They said, hey, this was a proposition that was actually posed to me by General Franks. Hey, we're worried about an event coming out. Tell me how we can prevent a video from going viral on social media utilizing a Thuraya satellite system. And I scratched my head and I said, I don't remember that module in my training. So suddenly you quickly realize that it's not just about the military side. It's understanding the entire infrastructure and how commercial infrastructure affects in what we do. We're going to see here very shortly within months, the emergence of 5G cellular technology. And what does 5G bring? I sat on a very interesting panel, actually now more years than I'd like to care to remember, but I sat with the National Science Foundation and on a panel called Enhancing Access to Radio Spectrum. And it was a very long table, by the way, of which I was at the very end, and I was the only one at the table whose nameplate didn't have honorable or doctor in front of it. And so I felt slightly uncomfortable, and as everybody went down and talking about all the wonderful things we were going to do with the emergence of 5G cellular technology and how this was going to, you know, revitalize Nobody talked about what the threat's going to do. Nobody assumed what bad things can happen. We certainly saw it in Iraq and Afghanistan and IEDs. Both Laurie and I lived through that, and many of you in this room, of how do we prevent key fobs and garage door openers and toy controllers from detonating devices that moved into cellular and every other potential commercial means. So in the end, I'll say one thing, open the aperture. We have to think much more holistically. We have to understand that our mission assurance is dependent upon the critical infrastructure of this nation, most of which is highly vulnerable. Most of which the threat is already inside, as which we've seen lately. So we have to, I think, expand our thinking. You know, I thought we were expanding it when we were looking at spectrum as a maneuver space and cyber and EW and IO as tools within that maneuver space. But I've come to realize that it's actually much broader than that. So again, I'd leave you with kind of the challenge of thinking about when you go back and look at what you're doing day to day and think about where are all those interdependencies that I need to do my job. We need to look at all those, because I tell you what, the adversary is not going to take us on airplane to airplane or tank to tank. They're not going to do it. They're going to look at that infrastructure and figure out, how do I disable that airframe? How do I disable that deployment from occurring? And it's not even about necessarily changing the information. What if I can just deny you that information for a few seconds? In cyber, that can be a few milliseconds that can have a devastating impact on the financial market. So we have a much bigger challenge, I think, than the past, and we've got a long way to go. We have to view acquisitions differently. We have to find ways to encourage and allow innovation. Part of that is shared risk, right? Because to be innovative, we don't know. We've got to try new things and do different things, and it's hard to do that when you want no shared risk between government and industry. Thank you.
Thank you, Fogg. But I'm not going to let you off the hook, because you answered the questions. But I would say that the work that we've done in the concept that you've described here about interdependencies allows you to think differently about cyber, about the physical impacting the SEMA and the information space. Not one by the other, but any way they want to come at those independencies. I'm gonna put you on the spot here in a little bit, because I think an important piece of today's discussion is for us to think about this idea of information operations and influence. And it's really been a long time, almost Kosovo, since we've worked our way through campaign planning. And now, how do we think about those requirements today as General Fogarty wrestles with, as the cyber COE wrestles with, how do you bring IO into this? What could we learn from the past that would inform requirements for the future? Because it's there every day, and it's not going away. So I'd ask you to think about that. Okay, let me do a couple questions while you send the rest of yours in, and we can get them from the big voice. Let me start with a pretty easy one. Each of you described a couple of things that industry could do or should be thinking about being able to do in support of DoD and Army. Put the other side of the coin on that and say, how can the Army better help each of you? As you think about it through your particular lanes here, EW, cyber, spectrum, influence, whichever lane you want to look at it from. Because we've got a lot of new constructs out there. We've got the Army's Futures Command. We're thinking about leveraging OTAs. Does the SEMA construct really help you with respect to filling requirements? Think about it in terms of what can the Army do to help industry? Anybody and
sure.
All.
Can I hit that?
Please, well.
Okay.
She didn't give me that question, by the way.
Okay, Dave Lockhart, are you here? Stand up.
Wow.
Nope. I want you to answer that question. No, Okay, question is, what can the Army do to better work with industry? Was that the question? Did I get that right? In these areas?
Is that working?
I think so.
Wow. We should have brought an extra chair.
How did I do, sir?
It works.
Okay, it's working. Okay, so this is something, I'm Dave Lockhart with Boeing. This is something we've been working on for the past probably at least 3.5 years. Just completed my doctorate in May of 2018. And I've been working with the acquisition system from 1995 up through 2011 before I retired. Been with industry for 6.5 years. Been able to see this situation, this question from both sides of the house, industry and government. And 80% of the requests that I get from my teams that I support is information. What does the government have? What information do they have that would inform us now as we're spending all this IRAD funding, right? And that's requirements related information, that's technical specs, that's ICDs, that's standards that are being developed as the government's working with a subset of partners. Share that with industry writ large as soon as practical so that the IRAD spending is more informed. And part of that was this idea of perpetual data repositories that you mentioned, Laurie. The idea of don't create a bidder's library at draft RFP and then shut it down after we submit proposals. Stand those things up and leave them up, perpetual or persistent requirements or information flows such that as we have funds to invest, we have the opportunity to go and look at those things before a contract is in place, before you put out RFIs, before you put out RFPs. Help us understand the user experience. Right now, as things happen in the field and users have experiences with equipment, good, bad, or indifferent, that information never makes it all the way back to industry. It makes it through the process somewhere, but we don't get the user experience. Now, in an open market, in a free market, we can do that. We can do focus groups. We can go out and look. In a monopsonistic environment, which is what this is, and that's not bad, it's just what it is, that comes from customers and customer representatives. And so I think that to the extent that DoD can figure out how to push information out to us earlier in the process, they'd be in a position to take advantage of the hundreds of millions and billions of dollars that companies are spending in IRAD.
Okay, excellent.
Cool. So, sir, to cap what he said so well, I think that we can expect a JSIDS process, even though we have new equipping forces, et cetera, in place. There's still an acquisition process that goes through an iterative process, first this and then this. But it's with a process, and it's very difficult to keep up with the pace of technology at a current pace of acquisition.
Yeah, great. Fogg, please.
Yeah, I just want to jump on because I think it's a great question, but I think there's real relevancy to what's happening, particularly here at Fort Gordon, and something that we see all the time. The one thing I would say is, Put security and resiliency requirements on the front end. And what do I mean by that? Basically, what happens is we're looking at it as Fort Gordon builds out and as our cyber builds out, and you look at your infrastructure, that infrastructure has to integrate with the mission. And so what you can't do is build physical structures and then come back and go, okay, now we need to make them secure and resilient. The cost of doing that is exponential. Vice building that in and defining those requirements on the front end and saying, hey, we want something that's going to be resilient and secure from the front end. If you don't build it into the RFP at the front end, I don't care what bidder you are or what contract you are, you're not going to put it in your proposal because you'll lose. You'll lose on price and you're putting things in that aren't in the requirements. But yet if we do it afterwards, the cost is exponential and the ability to do it effectively is dramatically reduced. So we have to move some of those things up. And that goes back to my comment about the physical and the digital worlds. You can't build the building and then go, well, now we're going to bring in the guts and the infrastructure, and we want it all secure. we really want to, you need to sit down with the designers at the beginning of that, from the industrial control systems, how we're going to control power, air, all of that. How's that going to be managed? If you do it on the front end, you save tremendous amounts of money. The second thing I would encourage the Army to look at, and really an acquisition overall, there's a big focus on getting something. What's the cost at IOC? Look at the cost of the life cycle, because I can get you something cheap, quickly, that is tremendously more expensive over the life cycle. I'd like to see us thinking about, because the threat's evolving so rapidly, we have to really look over the life cycle of any type of project, not just at bringing it at IOC.
So how about if I combine both questions with one answer? You asked, how can the Army help industry, and how do we integrate all this? Why does the Army still have three PEOs? EIS, C3T, IEW. Blinding flash. Integrate it. That would help industry. It would help one enterprise network. It would help all of that.
I'm still trying to figure out if I only ask one question.
Sir, if I may have
excellent.
One
thanks,
answer as
Jeff.
Well, and I do want to combine one of the questions that you were asking us is how do you leverage AI? So this goes back to what the gentleman from Boeing was talking about, is this information sharing, and I'm going to take a little bit more technical approach to this. In order for AI to learn, it has to have information from the network. It's got to be able to do something, and we have to train it, and we have to tune it. Magically out of the box, it doesn't do what you want it to do. It has to learn. And so we have to have a way in order to be able to collect telemetry from the government network, which today we are not able to, in order to train those systems so that we can deliver something to you that actually meets your requirements. And we cannot do that today. So when we do deliver the capability to you, it takes so long for it to learn something that from your perspective, it's not doing what you asked for it to do. And so from a technical perspective, there's got to be a way for us to figure out how to share this information, additional information, in order for us to be able to build these products to be able to meet your requirements a lot faster. So we got to figure this out. So thanks, sir.
Okay, fantastic. Questions, please.
All right, so we're bringing questions in on email off of the email address that's been up on the screen. The first question we have for the panel is, we talk a lot about developing and delivering exquisite effects, but exquisite effects often have a significant cost and take longer to deliver. If we overemphasize this approach, are we leaving the doors open to our adversaries?
If I can jump on that one really quick. Yeah, I think we are. So I think it's important to not assume that we're the smartest kid in the class all the time. Other nations are doing electronic warfare, cyber, and information operations, information warfare, and they're doing it really well. So I think it's important for us to not only for vulnerability assessments for our own stuff, but in order just to learn. You know, I mean, half the technology was ours and stolen anyway, so you look at China. So I think it's important to look what others are doing. Not everyone is using exquisite technology. You got a deck of cards. Some of it is very exquisite. Some of it's using national assets. Some of it is rather crude, but quite effective. Just because it is not today's or tomorrow's technology doesn't mean it's no longer useful on a battlefield. Tank's been around a long time. It's still pretty effective. We need to consider that you have to have a whole range of capabilities that you can use against a potential adversary. Fogg Hahn down at the end has worked with this stuff for years, especially as a Marine EWO. I know he had some very fine, very precise electronic fires, and at other times it was extremely powerful and meant to impact a large area. So I think it's absolutely critical to have the full range of capabilities and not to throw out the old stuff, but some of that stuff's still very good. Very quickly, look at the old Seaweed battalions. Look at what a great concept those were and look how old those were. Those go back to the 70s. But very, very, very good stuff, some very good concepts there.
I was just going to, a thought came to mind on that question, and I think sometimes, first of all, it's a great question. I think sometimes we actually overthink problems and forget to look at the simplest solutions, as well as not having the data to understand what should be plainly evident. Let me give you an example. Al-Qaeda figured out that they didn't have to design a sophisticated intercontinental ballistic missile. They simply had to learn how to take over an airplane with box cutters and fly it into a building full of fuel, and it had the exact same effect. Incredibly unsophisticated, but incredibly effective. And if you look at it from an intelligence perspective, the data was all there to tell us that that was occurring. I just take it back to the AI portion, because I think it's going to be imperative from the intel side that we be able to produce the data and look at it. When we finally, if you look at read the 9/11 report and you look at the data was all there. We just couldn't put it together to see the picture. So I do worry sometimes that we look for, you know, these very sophisticated systems and not looking at, is there a simpler solution that could have the same effect?
The other thing I want to add is there's a lot of times when the Army does make the right decision, they invest in the exquisite effect. They buy the best all think product, but it takes so long to field and to actually put it in the hands where it needs to be that by the time it gets there, it's lost. It's a advantage. So it's something else to consider as well.
Okay, I got lots of thoughts, but I'll go to the next question.
All right, sir, the next question is for Mr. Hahn. What can you share about the innovation takeaways from the Jack Voltaic exercise in Houston? We are interested in what the exercise implications are for realistically managing risks, preventing and responding to ever-changing threats to Army operations, especially regarding the non-military and commercial infrastructures and services needed to successfully conduct military operations.
I have an hour to answer that, right?
And I'm glad you are.
So again, Jack Voltaic 2 was a really fascinating exercise run by Army Cyber Institute and led by General Hernandez. Really designed to look at how we react to multiple threats. And if you think about it, it's a pretty realistic scenario, right? Hurricane coming into Houston, an adversary saying, you know, you have plenty of time, right? Hurricanes don't build up overnight. You typically have days and saying, hey, we want to combine an attack. What did we find out about it? First of all, I think we found out and we were able to exercise relationships that previously had not been exercised. And if we had to exercise them during the actual event, if that were a real event, would be very challenging. So we've gotten connectivity and people understanding assets and resources and how do we leverage those by doing it in peacetime, which is something we clearly want to take advantage of. We also understood and began to understand interdependencies that I think before we probably didn't know or probably didn't think about. I'm just going to give you one. We'll have a final after action report here in a few weeks. But one interchange I just thought was fascinating. I was sitting on kind of the SOC floor, and one of the injects was that they had hacked into the water system. And they had the guy that was representing the Houston, you know, basically the water department there. And he said, well, that's impossible. He said, our system's completely self-contained. It's untouchable. And I thought, wow, that's interesting. So we asked the question, so how do you manage or maintain the system? So you go, oh, we have a vendor. When we have a problem, he comes out and hooks his laptop up to it and he fixes it. Do you look at that laptop? Well, no, it's the vendor's laptop. So as for the cyber professionals in this room, you look at that and say, that's probably one of the most ludicrous things you've ever heard, right? Somebody that you don't know, who has no clearance, who shows up and plugs a laptop in one of the most critical infrastructures in this country, and then we say it's ironclad. What could go wrong? By the way, the inject was that particular employee had recently been fired and was having, but do they know that? So I just say that I think what we learned is that the interdependencies are much more far-reaching. We have all kinds of assets, but we don't necessarily know how to access them. We have different authorities. Things have to happen in certain sequences. So by doing this and exercising and thinking in a new way, I think it makes us more resilient, more secure, because we are able to work through those friction points and hopefully and develop relationships. So God forbid if something happens, we're not doing that for the first time.
Yeah, so I have to just say a couple things. One is we clearly learned the significance, what we already know, and the importance of collaboration, coordination, and communication. We tend to take that back to the simple basic of information sharing, but it's much harder than that, what we've all done in our military careers. The second piece is that as a nation, we need a repeatable framework that allows cities where the rubber meets the road to be able to routinely check their ability to protect critical infrastructure, and most importantly, so that from a military perspective, our defense critical infrastructure continues to operate, because we know the threats coming to us before we go anywhere. So how is it that we can count on cities to provide the critical infrastructure protection we need to do the business that we may be asked to do? And the last point I make is partnerships, private-public partnerships at that level are exponentially hard, and probably as hard as any international partnership that we're creating. Please, next question.
Okay, sir, this will be the last question for this panel. While it is easy to understand how industry has much to offer in cyber defense, it's not as apparent how industry has a similar set of experiences in electronic warfare in order to produce the right EWEA solutions needed by the Army. Could the panel address how it thinks industry can use its experience to produce and prototype electronic warfare solutions?
Yes.
Okay. I was going to let someone else talk about this, but if they want to. But so an emitter is a collector, is an emitter is a collector, is an emitter is a collector. And like General Napper said, you know, we're all doing the same thing. Your processing speed, you have, you know, different types of antenna, different power, you know, different waveform issues when you're dealing with electronic attack, voice, vice, C4ISR. Not necessarily, though. I think we're making it too hard. And I think General Corelli asked me one time, says, why can't the Intel guys and the signal guys work together and put everything in one box? And I said, well, the PEOs are separated by two glass doors up at APG. That's it. And you've got Fort Huachuca here, and you have the signal center here. And maybe it's down to money. But, you know, honestly, I think we're really trying to make it too exquisite. I think it goes down to the tribes that General Fogarty was talking about yesterday. These are tribal issues, not material acquisition issues. And I see the tribes beginning to be broken down. I think we have some extraordinary leaders. You had General Hernandez as a combat arms officer come in and take Cybercom. I think that was like one of the biggest steps. Because look, this is all about warfighting, and we're all part of that team. So let's break down some of the stovepipes and start working a little closer together. So I think we're making it harder than it needs to be in terms of EW, vice, any other type of acquisition.
Yeah, I'll jump, Mo, if you don't mind, I'll jump on that. I think she answered that very well, and I would say that my experience, both from running the Joint Electronic Warfare Center and being in command EWO for CENTCOM, is I'll give you an example. I can't go into detail, but we had a box that was operated by one intel community that was in the SAP-SAR arena that was operated the exact, keep in mind, this is the exact same box that was operated by another community that was unclassified. And you say, how can that be? But it's intent. And I think that the tribal kind of mentality is what I've seen. I can't put any clearer than Mo put it, right? Emitter's an emitter, a collector's a collector. The only difference typically is what we're collecting for or why we're emitting, right? So when we look at it, so I do think we need to kind of break down some of those organizational barriers and understand, you know, why we do certain things. When I was at CENTCOM, every single EW application that I wanted to use that was in a classified program was naysayed by NSA every single time. Now, that's not right. It's not that NSA was bad, it's, but they had a different purpose and a different culture. Their culture was collect, 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 right? And if you jam, I'm not collecting. And so I don't want to jam, I want to collect. We have to understand there's a time and place for both.
Yeah, that's fantastic. I just add one thing from Houston again. Cities are getting smarter whether they want to or not. And all of that adds to the spectrum. And every day they're dealing with 9/11 calls that we have trouble fathoming how many there are that's dealing with that. And others are looking to take advantage of that. So there's huge opportunity where industry is partnering with cities and critical infrastructure sectors are working to ensure they maintain their freedom to operate, and how we can bring that, those lessons and those capabilities to us is really what the question's about, and we should be looking at leveraging those partnerships more in my mind.
Sir, thank you very much. That was our final question for the panel. Please welcome back General Wood to the stage to thank them on behalf of AFCEA and the audience. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much. Let's give him a hand. You know, I can truly say that you all are the lucky ones. This is a remarkable panel. Great insights, great expertise, great application in the mission set that we've been talking about this week. I couldn't thank you more, Rhett, for what you did, and this panel for what you've accomplished, and really the insights you're leading the industry with. It's truly refreshing, great, big problems, but it looks like we got some big brains working on it. So I appreciate that. I picked up a couple things, you know, collecting telemetry, man, slap in the face. We got to figure out how that could happen. Get those, we'll send you to CECOM with that project of combining the PEOs, both of you there. With armor. We've heard about the tribes, but we really sense the convergence of those tribes and tribal insights. Very, very useful. Rhett, thank you so much. And on behalf of the panel, we will make a presentation to the Fisher House. Thank you so much. We have a couple last things to point out to the audience as we head out of here. Let's give them a hand again, one more time. Well, that's the final session in this room. The Women in AFCEA panel will actually take place next. The Women, Government, Industry, and Academia will discuss cybersecurity solutions, and that happens in the Engagement Theater on the floor about 15 minutes after this. Beginning also at 2:45, you can catch the final set of solution reviews across the way in Estes A. The Army RCO will also brief on cyber and emerging technologies, maybe some of this from the government perspective in Estes B. Or you can attend the Fort Gordon Augusta chapter course on DCOI Made Simple. That would probably be useful at this point. Thank to them, by the way, a great set of classes and instructional settings that the chapter has been helping us with. From 4 to 5 in the TechNet U hallway on the Riverwalk, we're showcasing research projects from the local students in our Future Leaders poster show back here where the reception will be. Please take a moment to stop by and see the kind of heart and soul they put into these projects. They certainly appreciate it in the Riverwalk hallway. We also have, importantly, women's panel that will be taking place. Looking forward to that. That's coming up here shortly. And then the tomorrow schedule will begin with coffee for early risers at 7. Once again, thanks to our sponsors for that. This time it's courtesy of Hortonworks, followed at 8:30 by a panel session on multi-domain operations led by Major General John Morrison. We've heard a bit about MDO and a couple bits and pieces. We'll put it together as a panel. That'll be in here tomorrow. That takes place at 8:30. Following General Morrison's panel, we move to the exhibit hall for a coffee break, again sponsored by Hortonworks. Please make sure to visit those exhibitors. It'll be a last chance tomorrow morning. Don't forget the tabletop displays as well behind in the hallways. We have various breakout sessions throughout the morning before the closing keynote, so you can see them all listed on the wing boards as you see here. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your attention. We look forward to seeing you this evening. The women's panel, also the reception, and take a look at those poster projects. Thanks so much.